I'd like for us to prepare our hearts as we listen to God's word. Precious Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you. We thank you, King of the universe. We thank you for your love upon us. And we thank you, Lord, for the desire that you have to carry us from where we are and take us until we find ourselves in the kingdom of God. Lord, I thank you for the church. I thank you for the word of God. I thank you for the Spirit of God that teaches us and guides us as we move towards Canaan's land, Lord. Help us, Lord. Correct us if you have to. Show us your way. In Jesus' name we pray. My trust and confidence in God is that every time we come into the presence of God, that there is always a desire in your heart, like there is a desire in mine, to hear the voice of God and to get instruction and direction from God. We have got to have a yielding to God. We must have an ability to listen and to hear from God. And then after we have heard from God, we must have the courage to follow the instruction that God has given to us if we are going to make it to the kingdom of God. When the Apostle Paul writes and talks about scripture, when he says all scripture is God-breathed, when the Apostle Paul says that all scripture comes by the inspiration of God, he's talking about the Old Testament. He's talking about the Hebrew scriptures. He's talking about Genesis to Malachi. And when the Apostle Peter is writing here and says, us knowing this first, that no prophecy of the scripture is of any private interpretation, he's talking about Genesis to Malachi. You see, in the time of Paul and in the time of Peter, the New Testament was not in existence. The New Testament were just a few of them were letters that had been written to groups and saints of God and to churches. And they had not yet been elevated to the level of scripture. They had not been canonized. They had not been accepted yet. Nobody even thought it was necessary to have them as part of scripture. Indeed, I hold the entire Bible as a word of God. I hold the entire word from Genesis to Revelation as scripture. In a sense, we must understand that the Old Testament is very vital in our salvation, because it is the one that has proof and shows the map of our salvation. It is the one that introduces Jesus to us, and it's the one that Jesus came to fulfill. And it is by obedience to that word in Genesis to Malachi that Jesus thought about and read and meditated upon and understood to be the word of God. Now, I'm not saying the New Testament is not the word of God. I have already told you it is the word of God. But we have got to understand that the things written aforetime, Romans chapter number 15 and scripture verse number 4. I think let's begin there. And looking at scripture verse number 4, it says, Because whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning, that we, through patience and comfort of the scriptures, might have hope. Now, the word of God, when we read the word of God, whether we are reading in the Old Testament or whether we are reading in the New Testament, we are able to build hope. We are able to build expectation. When we are suffering, we are able to see men and women that went through sufferings, but God delivered them. We are able to see people that went through difficult situations, but they had hope because God appeared for them. If people like Abraham made it to a place where they became friends of God, even we ourselves too, in our generation, can also pursue the same journey and become friends of God. And if people like Saul or of Tarsus later on became Paul of Tarsus because of having a relationship with Jesus Christ. We too also, we can turn from being enemies of God into friends of God. Because the things written aforetime, they were written for our learning, that we through patience and comfort of the scriptures, we may have hope. Hallelujah. Amen. And because we serve again the God of hope, verse 13 of the same chapter that we are reading here, he says, and now the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that ye may abound in hope through the power of the Holy Ghost. Praise the name of the Lord our God. I mean, we can have hope because we have a God of hope. A God that came and visited Abraham and told him that Sarah, your wife, next year, this time, she will be having a baby. And that gave him hope. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. Amen. That gave him hope. Amen. And he was able to persevere. He was able to wait. And in Exodus chapter number 17, I want us to look at an incident in the life of the children of Israel. They had just left Egypt. They had crossed the Red Sea and had reached this place known as Rephidim, the place of rest. Place of rest. Rephidim simply means a place of rest. People murmured. In chapter number 17, two major things happened in that chapter. One of them is that people are murmuring because there is no water, and people are asking themselves questions, like many times children of God ask themselves questions. Have you ever asked yourself this question? Is the Lord among us or not? Is God with this church or not? Well, that's exactly what these people, they got to this place where they were asking by complaining about water. But I want to begin here in verse number 6. He said, behold, this is God. The Lord said to Moses, go on before the people and take with thee the elders of Israel and thy rod wherewith thou smotest the river, take in thine hand and go. I will stand before you there upon the rock in Horeb, and thou shalt smite the rock, and there shall come water out of it, that the people may drink. And Moses did so in the sight of the elders, and he called the name of the place Massah and Meribah, because of the chiding of the children of Israel, and because they tempted the Lord, saying, is the Lord among us or no? And right there, when they entertained doubt in their life, verse number 8, then, while they are doubting the presence of God in their midst, when they are not sure that God is with them or no, then came Amalek and fought with Israel in Rephidim. What a time. Just at the point where we entertain doubt, the devil strikes. The devil is able to bring a battle in your life when you begin doubting God. When you begin doubting God in your life, when you begin doubting whether you are saved or not, when you begin doubting whether you are on the right path or not, when you begin doubting, then the devil, like a roaring lion, jumps in and he wants now to strike you and to destroy you. Now Amalek attacked Israel without provocation. The Amalekites often attacked for pleasure, without provocation, for no reason at all, they attacked. And Amalek in scripture stands for the enemies we face, the difficult situations that we find ourselves in. You must discover your weak areas. You must discover the things that you have to be careful about and deal with them. Because if you don't deal with them, the enemy will take advantage of your weak area. And Moses said to Joshua, choose us out men. Do what? Choose from among us men. Joshua is the same name as the name of Jesus. You see, Jesus is Greek. We should actually be calling our Savior Yeshua. That's what we are supposed to be calling him. Yeshua or Yehoshua. That's his name. That's the name that he was called, and the name he had, people calling him. He was Joshua. He was Yeshua. He was Yehoshua. All these are variants of the same name in the Hebrew. Even when you read in the New Testament, and you shall call his name Jesus, because he shall save. Because Yeshua, Yehoshua, means deliverer. It means that God is salvation. The name of Jesus, when you say Jesus, you are saying, you're saying that God is a deliverer. God is salvation. And it is instructive that Moses calls Joshua and he tells him, choose us out men and go out fight with Amalek. And then he says, tomorrow I will stand on the top of the hill with the rod of God in my hand. I want us to talk about how to win spiritual battles. How to win battles with God. The enemy will sure attack. That is, whether you like it or not. Whether you realize it is him or not. Sometimes you will think it is your brother. Sometimes you will think it is your boss. Sometimes you will think it is someone else. Or your neighbor. Or whoever it may be. You might even think the state is the problem. But I want to say here that the enemy is still the devil. It does not matter the means that he uses. I want us to ask ourselves a personal question. If I am chosen to go to battle, will I accept? If Joshua appoints me to be one of the few that are going to the battle, first of all, am I ready to go? Am I qualified enough to go? And will I even accept to go? A great many people in the house of God are not qualified for battle. They have not trained themselves for battle. And a great many, again, are not willing to go and fight for God. Are you willing to be in arm's way? Children of God, hide when it is time to fight for the kingdom of God. When it is time to do something and bring salvation and deliverance to the work of God. They hide. They switch their phones off. Look at scripture verse number 9. We're in Exodus 17. And Moses said unto Joshua, choose us out men and go out and fight with Amalek tomorrow. I will stand on the top of the hill with the rod of God in my hand. That we are not going to succeed in our battles unless we have these two categories of people. People, number one, that are ready to go to the heat of the battle, and people that are ready to stand before God in intercession. These are the two that we need in order to have victory in battle. We need people that can stand with the rod of God lifted, people that can intercede for others who must go into the heat of the battle into harm's way. If we do not have people that are ready to go to the front lines, if we do not have people, if everybody says, let us pray, let us pray, let us intercede, and no one wants to get into and make their fingers and their hands dirty, if no one wants to get to the battlefield, we are not going to get victory. Victory will only be attained when these two work together. When we have people in the battlefield and we have people in the prayer room. Each one of us has a place where God has appointed for us. And don't you run from your place of appointment. We all cannot fit behind the Bible stand. But we all can fit where God wants each one of us to fit. Every joint must supply something so that the body of Christ can become what God wants her to become. Verse number 10. So Joshua did as Moses had said unto him, and fought with Amalek, and Moses, Aaron, and Hur went up to the top of the hill. Joshua went to the battle to fight with Amalek, but Moses and Aaron and Hur, they went to the top of the hill. Now there is something interesting about these people and their names. Of course, you know Moses means drawn or taken out of. We know Moses is the leader. We know Moses is the representative of leadership here. But now Joshua is a deliverer, so he must go to the field. By the use of his sword, he will bring deliverance to God's people. But Moses goes to the hill with his elder brother, Aaron. Now, Aaron means mountain of strength. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. And it just tells me mountain of strength in prayer. Hallelujah. There is a dynamic power in this man, Aaron, when it comes to him being on the mountain with God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And then this man, Hur, we know very little about this man. There are about three or four people that are known as Hur in the Bible, but this is one of the greatest. Hur means liberty. Liberty. And the scripture comes into my mind. It says, where the Spirit of God is, there is liberty. Hallelujah. This man, whatever he was and whatever he is, and I don't want to make a lot of doctrine and a lot of things out of people's names, but it is just interesting how that liberty, the mountain of strength, as liberty with God and as power with God, and together with Moses, who is having the posture and the position of an intercessor, lifting up his holy hands unto God, by them, by their prayer, and by their standing God, the children of Israel are having victory led by the deliverer, Joshua. Praise the name of the Lord our God. And it came to pass, when Moses held up his hand, that Israel prevailed. And when he let down his hand, Amalek prevailed. This is not just a statement that every time the hands of Moses are down, then the Amalekites are going to be advancing to destroy. No, this is a statement after observation. This is a statement after observation. They are on a hill. The battle is in the valley. And they are able to see the battle. And they went up to pray. And they are praying. And Moses' hands are up in prayer. And this is not a 1 hour prayer, my friend. Scripture says they stayed in that place until the going down of the sun. And while they were there praying and calling upon God, someone made an observation. And noticed that When Moses managed to have his hands up, the Israelites were pushing back the Amalekites. And when his hands were down, the Amalekites were pushing back the children of Israel. It's an observation. And this is how we are going to win. We must have people in prayer. We must have people in intercession. We must have people that have power with God in prayer. Hallelujah. Amen. The church will only progress when we lift up our hands to God. The church will only overcome the temptations and the trials and the attacks of the enemy if we have power with God. If we lift up our hands to God, we must, when we notice that one of us is going through a challenge, it's not a time to gossip. It's a time to go up the hill and lift up the rod of God. Yes. Hallelujah. And lift up high praises to God. Amen. And the two-edged sword in our hands. Amen. And pray, lift up that sister, lift up that brother. Not gossip about them, not talk about them, but pray that God will deliver them, that God will give them victory. Verse 12. But Moses' hands were heavy. It has never been easy to guide the work of God. It's never been easy to lead saints of God. It's never been easy to be a pastor. It has never and it will never be easy to be a leader of God's people. Moses' hands were heavy. It's a burden. Apostle Paul talked about the constant care of the churches, of the saints of God. And yet sometimes saints of God will do things so that askew. And Moses' hands were heavy. He was weary. He was tired of lifting up his hands and the rod of God in his hand. It was becoming heavy for him. It was not easy. It was become heavy and difficult for him. And thank God for godly support. Thank God for people that can see there is a heaviness in this man lifting up his hands. And they can come and lift up those hands and make a support so that, and Moses' hands were heavy. And they took a stone and put it under him. And he sat thereon. And Aaron and Hur stayed up his hands. The one on the one side and the other on the other side. And his hands were steady until the going down of the sun. Would to God that the church would have brothers and sisters that can come and ensure that the weight can be reduced. Hallelujah. Aaron came on one side. He may have been on the left, he may have been on the right, it doesn't matter. But Hur was on the other side. And they ensured that their hands were up. Hallelujah. Aaron and Hur must have been standing. I want you to see, lest you miss the point. I did not say that Aaron and Hur ensured that because Moses was an old man, he kept his hands up. Aaron was Moses' elder brother. Listen to me very carefully. Aaron did not look at his age and the fact that he is the elder brother of Moses and say, well, go ahead with your business. I'm an elderly man. No. Aaron, though the elder brother of Moses, supported Moses in the mission that God had called him. Aaron recognized that Moses was the man that God has called. Are you able to stand with a younger man than you are, a younger person than you are, because of the call of God upon their life? Or are you saying that, I got saved before them. I'm older than the pastor. He should be coming to me for counsel. That's not the attitude that Aaron had. Aaron supported the man of God. I'll repeat. I say Aaron, Moses' elder brother, supported the man of God, Moses. Now that should be a lesson to every last one of us. Hallelujah. It's another thing that we learn out of this account. The importance of unity of purpose. Apostle Paul writing, he said in Philippians chapter number 2, and also in 1 Corinthians, I believe chapter number 1, around verse number 10 or so. But in Philippians chapter number 2, being of one mind and being of one accord. The church, if we are going to succeed in the mission that God has given to us, we must be of one mind. We must be of one purpose. We must have unity of purpose. The children of Israel had one enemy, and that was Amalek. And together, all of them together, some went into the field to fight. Others went on their knees to call on God for the same purpose. They are working together. It says in verse number 2 of Philippians chapter number 2, fulfill ye my joy that you be like-minded. You think alike. You be of the same mind. Be of the same purpose. Fulfill ye my joy that you be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind, let nothing be done through strife or vain glory. Victory will come when the church is in one mind. Hallelujah. When the church stands as one man. One man, that means you have one mind. And we have one head, and that's Christ. What is Christ telling us? Who to God we submit to Him? Who to God we listen to Him? Who to God we hear Him and know what He wants? And I want to very quickly turn to Ephesians chapter number 4, where we mentioned this scripture. I don't want it to skip our attention here. Reading verse number 16. He says, for context purposes, let's begin in verse number 14. That we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro, and carried with every wind of doctrine, by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive. But speaking the truth in love, may grow up unto Him in all things, which is the head, even Christ. Now listen to me, brethren. Do all you can to have Jesus as your source. Do all you can to have the mind of Christ fill you. Again, in Philippians, where we are coming from, chapter number 2, it says, let this mind be in you. Let this mind be in you, which also was in Christ Jesus. Now, the mind that we are supposed to be having, the thinking that we are supposed to have, the reasoning that we are supposed to be having, the way of looking at things that we are supposed to be having, is the same way that Jesus looked at things. Think like Christ. Hear Him. This is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased. Hear Him. That we may grow up to Him in all things. In your thinking, in your reasoning, in your attitude, in the way you look at things, in the way you see things. Let me ask you a question. What do you think Jesus thinks about His church? Think like that. Grow up unto Him in all things, which is the head, even Christ. From whom? From Christ. Who is the head? From the head, that is from Christ, from whom the whole body fitly joined together. Fix yourself in God. Fix yourself in Christ until when Jesus thinks, you know what He's thinking. I know it's not as easy as I'm saying it. I don't even want it to be easy, because it is not easy. We must look for how to hear Him. How to begin thinking like He thinks. From whom the whole body, fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplieth, every joint, every brother, every sister must supply to the body of Christ. There is a place for you in the work of God. There is a place for you in the economy of God. There is a place for each and every last one of us. There is a position and there is a work. There is a purpose. Each one of us has got a purpose in God. And God has invested in you. God has invested in each and last one of us gifts and talents and abilities that God wants to be used in the work of God and in the world, so that the work of God may succeed. For Joshua, it was being in the battlefront. For Moses, it was on the hill lifting up his hands. For Aaron, it was ensuring that one of the hands of Moses was lifted up. And for her, the same. Each in their place. Then victory will come in the camp. Each one of us must discover their place in God. Each one of us must discover what God wants specifically to accomplish through us. It may be one thing, it may be two things, maybe three if God has gifted you in several areas of your life. But there is something for you to do. He says, by which every joint supplieth, according to the effectual working. Make your work have an effect. You see, the hands are strategically placed in their rightful place
in the body because of the things that the hands have got to do. The fingers are blessed in the place where they are supposed to be most effective. The feet are put not on the place where the head is, and the head is not put where the feet are. That would be too bad for a head. And you too must find your place in God. You too must find your place in the work of God. You see, victory is dependent on unity and cooperation of the saints of God. Unity in the work of God is dependent. It depends on the cooperation of the saints of God when each is doing their part. I want to close with these scriptures here in the book of Romans, chapter number 12, if I may. In Romans chapter number 12, verse number 5, we being many are one body in Christ, and everyone members of one another. Verse 6, having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us. In other words, each one of us has a gift that may be different from the gift in the other person. But all these gifts, they are gifts that must be used in the work of God and in the mission that God has given the church today. He says, whether prophecy. In other words, to some, they have a gift of prophecy. So, if the gift that God has given to you is to speak sacred secrets or to speak the word of God, as it were, let us prophesy according to the proportion of faith. Or if God has given you the gift of ministry, he says, let us wait on our ministering. Or if God has given you the gift of teaching, then you should do your gift in teaching. Verse number 8. Or he that exhorteth on exhortation. And he that giveth, let him do it with simplicity. He that ruleth, let him rule with diligence. He that showeth mercy, let him do it with cheerfulness. And let love be without dissimulation. Let love be without favoritism. Let love be without favoritism. God wants some of us to be in the field of prayer. Others to be in the field of doing physical work. At a time when we are setting out to build a sanctuary for God, we will need some brothers and sisters that will come and make their hands dirty. And others will give finances. And what does God require of us? God requires faithfulness. God wants you. Now, because God has invested in each and every last one of us, God expects you to use the gift that he has given to you in the work of God. Hallelujah. I say victory will come because each one of us will do what we are supposed to do. Hallelujah. And some of us, it is just lifting up the hands of the man of God. And some of us is just keeping the devil at bay with our prayer, probably with our prayer and fasting. Victory is assured. With the high praises of God in our mouth and the two-edged sword in our hands, we will march to victory's side, right into Canaan's land. Praise the name of the Lord our God. I want us to pray as we ask God to give us diligence in doing that which he wants us to do. God would love us to intercede for his work. God would want us to cooperate with one another. God would want us to give to leadership godly support. Precious Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord of glory, we recognize that many times the devil attacks the work of God. But we, Lord, like Moses and like Joshua, like Aaron and like Hur, have got each of us a part to play in bringing victory to the camp of God. Help us, my God, to supply according to the gifting of God in our lives. Lord, help us to be sober. Help us to be vigilant. Help us, my God, to notice when the enemy comes in roaring like a lion to devour whom he may. Help us, my God, to rise up against him. Scripture tells us, when the enemy
shall come against us like a flood. The Spirit of God will lift up a standard against him. Lord, help us to be that standard that is lifted against the enemy, so that we may have victory in the work of God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Let us cooperate with God.